আমরা আজকে এসেছি মানে গ্যালভেস্টনের কাছে একটা জায়গা, বিশপস প্যালেস। তো ওটা একটা রাজপ্রাসাদ, তো এখানে আমরা চলে এসেছি, তোমাদের সাথে শেয়ার করছি, তোমরাও দেখো।
Bishop's Palace, named for Bishop Byrne, who lived here. But before he took up residence, it was home to one of Galveston's most prominent families, the Greshams, who broke ground on the site in 87. Take a couple of minutes to look around this amazing entry hall, and I'll help you imagine what Galveston looked like as the 19th century drew to a close. The sound of the hammer and saw, and the ring of the trowel, were phrases that appeared often in the pages of the Galveston Daily News.
So this is 3 and 4. This is called music room. And then 4 is your altar. As you can see here. Yeah, this is very nice. So this is the historic building in the Galveston. So this is called Bishop's Palace. Okay. My God, this is really good. So we cannot touch here, so better to keep. Do not touch anything. So this is the music room, and we can go to the next one. You can see here, very nice. This is 6th one for Linden. Oops. I think of this one. It's the number 6th. You can see here. Now we're coming to the 7th place. Can you see? This is the very history. It is old, 1857. This is library. So different type of books.
As Galveston transitioned from gas to electric lighting, many houses had light fixtures called gasoliers that incorporated both technologies. The columns flanking the hat table on the west side of the hall and the seat opposite are Siena Italian marble. Walter Gresham had this home built for him and his family between 1887 and 1892 for the grand sum of $250,000. Galveston architect Nicholas, on the right side of the cabinet, belonged to the Greshams. The oyster plates and the covered soup cups with saucers are Hamlet. The soup set is hand painted and was probably done specifically for the Greshams. Mrs. Gresham had an appreciation for fine china. Bishop Byrne expanded the kitchen after moving in, adding a stove. It was a simple, warming kitchen back when the Greshams were in residence. The original full kitchen was located in the basement. staff couldn't escape Mrs. Gresham's watchful eye. She ran the house with a firm hand, and it certainly didn't escape her notice that the cook was moving the hands of the kitchen clock to hide the fact that she was often late to work. Mrs. Gresham's solution was to secure the clock to the door with a padlock. The family descendant who told us this story still has the clock to prove it. The Galveston city directories from the 1890s show that the Greshams usually employed three full-time servants who often resided at Bishop's Palace. A man, acting as general coachman and groundskeeper, was 5'7"2", and Mr. Gresham's office line
seen in the public parts of the house. Though the curly pine that was used here might look extravagant by today's standards, it was one of the least expensive materials used in the house, and this area's woodwork is designed in a much simpler fashion. The coat room was a busy spot during the many parties that took place here, as staff took and stored the wraps of family and guests. The small sink in the coat room is a Pullman sink, like the ones found in the luxury Pullman Railroad sleeping cars, developed by George Pullman of Chicago. Galveston Historical Foundation started managing the property. We decided to only feature furniture with a direct connection to either the Gresham family or Bishop Byrne. One of the few pieces on display is the wood box in the corner that held Josephine's postcard collection. It matches the calling card basket. Both were carved from linden wood from Austria. But the house itself would never have existed if not for one of Galveston's most successful families, the Greshams. Imagine coming to this stunning home on gala event. As you approach to the front door, oak branches is carved there to commemorate Mr. Gresham's service in the state legislature. As you ascend the staircase, stop for a moment on the small landing midway up, what the Gresham grandchildren used to call the pulpit, for the way you could look out on the floor below as if delivering a sermon. The stained and jewel glass windows, except for the one in the center, are originals. Bishop replaced the center window with one of St. Thérèse of Lisieux in 1937. If you look closely, you can tell that the window on the right is darker in color than the others. That's because it's an interior window and it's backlit with electric lights. Once you've reached the second floor landing, take a look around to see the plasterwork featuring intricately rendered lions for strength and children for innocence. All of these designs were drawn by Clayton and executed by John O'Brien, a sculptor and stone carver from Ohio who often worked with Clayton. The portrait hanging over the staircase is none other than Philip Gresham and one of the family dogs. The Greshams used this landing area as a family sitting room, as one of the coolest rooms in the house. The family spent most of the summer here, often listening to their photographs. Furnished in white wicker, the entire area was decorated with rugs, ferns, and various hanging flowers and vines. Eco-friendly and green designs are not just a new phenomenon. The Gresham House was built with its surroundings and climate in mind. To hear about the green features of the house, tap more. The bedroom to the far west of the second floor landing once belonged to one of the Gresham girls, Beulah. It later became Bishop Byrne's bedroom. Christopher Edward Byrne was born in Burnsville, Missouri, in 1867, received his bachelor's degree from St. Mary's College in Kansas when he was 19, and was ordained to the priesthood in 1892. After many years in Missouri, he was consecrated the fourth bishop of Galveston, an office he held until his death in 1950. Bishop Byrne lay in state in the downstairs front parlor. He often said, "I never thought that a farm boy from Missouri would find a castle in the sky in faraway Galveston." Bishop Byrne chose this as his bedroom out of appreciation for its southern exposure and the pleasant air circulation that came with it. He also enjoyed the private balcony and the large closet that he later converted into a bathroom. Catholic diocese bought the house, workers spent several months rewiring, painting, and installing new rugs and window treatments in the entire residence. That may sound like a lot of work, But this room, originally daughter Josephine's, underwent a major transformation. All of the windows were replaced with religious themed stained glass. Look at the details on the faces of the saints. That work was done with brushes and needles. The finest in the house, these windows were made by the H. Oitman Glass and Mosaic Studios in Linnich, Germany, in 1928. Founded in 1857, they are still in business. The altar, six prie-dieus, or kneelers, and the gold, lacquered brass, and onyx crucifix were ordered through Benziger Brothers, a firm specializing in Catholic publications and church fittings. Finally, look up. The mural represents Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and is directly painted onto the ceiling. The woodwork in this room is mahogany and satin wood, and the mantle is white marble. The large portrait hanging on the north wall is Bishop Burke. This was the coolest bedroom in the house, thanks to southeast exposure and generous ventilation. It belonged to Mr. Gresham. In historic photographs, the abundant windows that provided the cross breeze all had long decorative curtains. The pink Italian marble fireplace in the center of the room is ornamented with a G for Gresham. The mantle was decorated with lace and ceramic pieces, and a large painting covered the entire space above the mantle. The portraits near the bed are of either Walter Sr. or Walter Jr., and of Mrs. Gresham. This room, like each of the other bedrooms, also had a marble washstand. During the 1900s storm, the Gresham house was refuge for many neighborhood residents. Luckily for them, the house suffered relatively light damage, while buildings around them, like the first Sacred Heart Church just across the street, were destroyed. The damage was limited to a flooded basement and buckled parquet floors, the result of salt spray driven through the broken windows. Replacing the window glass cost Mr. Gresham $300 at the time, several thousand of today's dollars, indicating that many windows were broken. Mrs. Gresham, who was home during the storm, left for a month's stay in New York shortly afterward to escape the devastation. The young female subjects in the two paintings on either side of the bed are unknown. However, the one on the right is good enough, and the Corcoran Gallery in Washington, D.C. granted Mrs. Gresham the right to copy paintings there. Like many 19th century houses of this stature, there were several bathrooms located throughout the house. Mrs. Gresham's was certainly nicely appointed. The linen closet to the left was used, as you might expect, to store towels and sheets. The toilet was modernized and replaced in 1910. The fixtures were purchased out of the J.L. Mott Ironworks catalog. Much of the house's exterior ironworks, including the winged lions, were the work of J.L. Mott as well. The tile is the work of Minton Tiles from London, England. You might have noticed something different about the bathtub. It has three water faucets. There is, of course, one each for hot and cold, and a third for rainwater. After all, rainwater is best for washing hair. To hear about the Gresham children, tap on more. The northeast bedroom was probably a guest room. By the children's Irish governess. Either way, the lack of southern exposure made it unsuitable for prolonged use. Mounted on easels in this room, you can see the plans for the floor of the house. In addition to the Gresham boys' bedrooms, the cedar closet, Mrs. Gresham's painting studio, and storage were all on the third floor. Bishop Burke used it for Mrs. Reeves, office space, and storage. The large center room on that floor was possibly used as a nursery.
আজকে গ্যালভেস্টনে ওই বিশপস প্যালেসে এসেছিলাম। এটা 1892-তে হয়েছিল, রাজপ্রাসাদটা তৈরি হয়েছিল। রাজপ্রাসাদের পুরো ভিডিওটা আমরা দিয়ে দিয়েছি, আমরা দেখাবো। তো এটা এখন আমরা নাপছি সেকেন্ড ফ্লোর থেকে। এটা হচ্ছে সিঁড়ি নামার, এইভাবেই আমরা উঠেছিলাম। পুরো গা ছমছমে একটা ব্যাপার, এখানে জানি না দেখি কতটা বুঝতে পারবে আমরা। আমাদের তো বেশ ভয় ভয়ই লাগছে এখানে।
This is another store, tip store.